Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple surprisingly released iOS 14.3 Release Candidate 2, or RC2. This is available to developers and public beta testers only, and will come out to the public a little bit later. Now, 2 days ago, they released Release Candidate 1, or RC1, and that usually is the final version that they release to the public, but they must have found something pretty big because they released this version and then released the entire thing again. So you'll see it came in at 4.54 gigabytes on my iPhone 12 Pro, and it was over 4 gigabytes on the iPhone 12 Pro, the 12 Pro Max, the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2020, and also the iPhone 6S Plus. So it had to fully reinstall the entire OS again, which is kind of surprising. So they must have found something, at least in the background, pretty big. Now, along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 14.3 RC2, along with macOS 11.1 RC, so release candidate. So they must be preparing all of these to release at the same time. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number, and then we'll talk about what's new. So we'll go back home, then go to settings on my 12 Pro Max. Since I didn't install it on the 12 Pro, so I could sort of compare them, we'll go to settings, then general, then about. Now you can see the build number is 18C66. We've stepped up from 18C65 with release candidate 1 to one more digit, 18C66. And this particular build must have had some significant fixes in the background, at least, since it had to reinstall such a huge update. Now, it includes all of the things I mentioned in RC1, such as Apple Fitness Plus support, AirPods Max support, photos with Apple Pro RAW support for the iPhone 12 Pro and 12 Pro Max, as well as privacy updates, TV, app clips, air quality in your weather app, Safari updates, and more with all of those bug fixes. However, there was one feature I missed because it was specific to the Apple Watch. So if you have watchOS 7.2 RC or the final version, you'll have some new options the first time you open your app if you have a supported device and you're in the correct country. So I'll go into my Photos app since I took some screenshots of it. You can't go back into it once you've set it up, but as soon as you open the Apple Watch app, you'll get cardio fitness levels. So this is something that's new that they've added. And this is a Series 6 Apple Watch, so it will make a difference if you have some of these features or not. But cardio fitness levels can be a strong indicator of your overall physical health and a predictor of your long-term health. So they're monitoring more, and you'll see it says lower your cardio fitness, and it gives information such as age, pregnancy, lung conditions, heart conditions, talks about more information. Then the next thing, you had to put in some information such as your age and weight and things like that, and date of birth. But the next screen shows about cardio fitness levels, and it talks about VO2 max. This is something that Apple talked about with watchOS 7, with the Series 6 Apple Watch, being able to measure that and look at your overall cardio fitness levels. So it talks about low cardio fitness notifications on the next screen, and you can turn those on or you don't have to. And then also it says setup complete. Now it shows you your VO2 max. Mine is quite low, and that's because I don't really wear this a whole lot. So we'll go to the next screen where there was some updates to ECG as well. So in the watch, you'll have those cardio fitness updates along with the ECG app having new capabilities. So once you hit update, you get to a screen that says it has new capabilities and can now check for atrial fibrillation at higher heart rates, or let you know your result is inconclusive due to poor recording. So maybe your watch band isn't that tight, it won't record properly, and it will let you know that. On the next screen, it just showed you can view your recordings, and then it says that it has new capabilities and shows you your rhythm throughout the day. Now you can see it says it has new capabilities. I had to go through this a couple times, and then it talks about poor recordings and more in detail. It also talks about four things to remember, such as it cannot detect a heart attack or blood clots or a stroke, and it cannot detect heart-related conditions, and you need to speak to your doctor if you have those problems. So it's all of those updates if you have an Apple Watch, which I think is really great to see. Now, other than that, there is nothing different in RC2. So that's in RC1 as well, but there's nothing that you can see physically that you'll be able to see. Maybe some slight changes to a couple of the graphical assets as far as AirPods Max, but that's from RC1 to 2, and no one will really see that unless you actually have the AirPods Max. Now, there were some issues that people mentioned previously with green tint issues on the iPhone 12 displays. We saw this before with iPhone 11s last year, and they fixed it with an update. But so far, it seems like this is not fixed. And I asked on Twitter, and Jury, as you can see here, he shows the green tint. So it's a little bit hard to see, but it actually has a green tint in dark situations. You can see the green there, and apparently it's not fixed. Now, as far as HDR issues and the screen sort of flickering and that happening, again, it's not an issue that I've actually had, so I asked on Twitter. I haven't had anybody reply about that yet. So if you know, please let us know in the comments below. Also, some people were saying when you go into an app and then you swipe up home that it could stutter a little bit. It seems like that's fixed in this update, so it looks like it's nice and fast. And again, on the iPad, I had stuttering before, and it seems like it's fixed on the iPad as well with that. So it looks like it's nice and fast. So thankfully, they've fixed that. They must have had some bugs before, but hopefully the green tint issue is fixed in a future update. I know they're looking into it, and I would expect that with a future update as well. Now, also, Apple reported that they were going to update the dual SIM 5G capability with a software update, but we haven't seen that yet, or at least they haven't mentioned it in this update. So whether or not you'll be able to use 5G at the same time with dual SIM cards is hard to say. But again, if you're on RC2 and you have dual SIM cards, let us know in the comments below, because Apple did not mention this specifically, and I don't use dual SIM cards. Now, as far as the release date, we know for sure that iOS 14.3 is required for Apple Fitness Plus, which releases on Monday. And so since that's the case, and then we'll have AirPods Max later that week, it seems like it could come as soon as tomorrow, but Monday may be likely. That's kind of an unlikely day for Apple to release an iOS update, but it seems like that's what it's going to be. So if we go into our calendar, on Monday the 14th would be the absolute latest. It's possible we'll see it tomorrow, but that's very unlikely. But Apple's doing all sorts of crazy releases right now and getting everything ready so they can have a little bit of vacation by the end of the year and then start again next year. So it's very possible we'll see it as soon as tomorrow. But again, Friday and Mondays are both unlikely, so we could see anything at this point. So hopefully we'll know by tomorrow and Monday at the very latest, we can expect it released to the public. Now, should you update to iOS 14.3 RC2? Well, if you're already on RC1 or any of the iOS 14.3 betas, absolutely you should update. That's just kind of part of the deal with that, and you'll have more stability in general. However, if you're on iOS 14.2, well, I would wait unless you know how to remove a beta and go back, or if you have problems. I really would just wait a few days for the final to come out, and then you'll be good to go, and you can just deal with any issues you have currently. If it's really bad, you could try updating, but I normally advise people just wait unless they know how to restore and that sort of thing using iTunes or a Mac with Finder. Now, as far as other issues, people were having issues with freezing, locking up, some other weird bugs here and there. But in this particular version, it seems like battery's been great with RC1. Now, I did mention in previous updates that my iPad Pro had some issues with battery, and iPad OS 14.3 RC1 seemed to fix most of the issues, but I did have some touch responsive issues and some lag. So let's take a look at the battery, though. There's no other features in this other than what I mentioned before, but I did charge it to 100% last night, and we're at 88% after installing the update, and we're down to 88%, and it was charged at 10:25 a.m. this morning. I was only getting about 6 hours. I think we're back to about 10 hours of screen on time, like I should be on that particular version. So I'm glad we're seeing that. Now, battery life overall on RC1 so far has been okay. It's only been a couple days, though. So if I go into my 12 Pro Max, go to the last 10 days, you'll see yesterday I had 3 hours and 4 minutes of screen on time, 1 hour and 59 minutes of screen off time, and I used about 40% of my battery or so, and that's pretty good. That means I'm going to get about 10 to 12 hours of screen on time, like I should expect with this phone. So it looks like battery life has been fixed. I know people that don't charge overnight were saying standby time has been fixed as well since updating to this version. So I think there's going to be quite a few improvements that people see once this version comes out. Now, as far as performance, well, I noticed that it is a little bit smoother. Some of the animations seem a little different. And on the 6S Plus, since it's the oldest here, you'll see it's smooth scrolling, and some of the animation speed seems a little bit different to me. It might be a little bit slower, but it seems smoother. I don't know if that's just me, but that's what it looks like to me. So if I go back out, go back in, go back home, go to music, for example, let it load and then scroll. It seems nice and fast, but really smooth as well. So I'm glad we're seeing that. And I'm seeing that on all of these devices that are updated. Now, as far as the overall Geekbench or benchmark scores, they actually went up quite a bit. So on my 12 Pro Max, I have 1,597 for single core, 4,146 for multi-core. If we take a look at the history, You'll see the other day with RC1, and I ran this right after updating. You'll see the other day with RC1, it was 1,586. We bumped up to 1,597, and then we're about 100 or so more, maybe a little bit less, 4,146 for multi-core versus 4,074 last time. So it looks like it's doing pretty good overall. On the 6S Plus, it did go down a little bit, but the phone was really hot when I first ran it. So 517 for single core, 994 for multi-core. The phone must be doing quite a bit in the background as it's a little bit warm. And then finally on the iPad, I ran it as well. Let's take a look. And I scored 1,125 for single core, 4,675 for multi-core. If we take a look at the history, it's kind of in the middle here. You'll see right here on the 10th versus the 8th, it's a little bit higher for single core and a little bit higher for multi-core. So we're doing well. Generally, this is a guide as to what it should perform like. It's not basically saying that it's going to be super fast. But in general, I'm really excited for this update. Of course, I'm looking forward to have them release this, and then we'll see more updates probably next year. So let me know if you found anything new in the update with RC2 in the comments below. And of course, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.